Our next speaker is Dr. Muhammad Arif Hashim. He's a medical doctor, graduated in 1982 from the National University of Malaysia. He was subsequently trained in pathology from London University and Nagasaki University in Japan. He has done a great deal for his country, including assisting to develop the Malaysian pathology information system, which was done within the country in-house. And he was a member of the international expert panel, which was charged in 1997 to develop the blueprint for the Malaysia telemedicine project, one of the most impressive and comprehensive ones in the developing world, or in the world, in fact. And he's currently the head of that telehealth work and the telehealth office, which is based within the Ministry of Health of Malaysia. He's also a member of the Asia-Pacific panel for the evaluation of telehealth applications. I give you Dr. Arif whenever you're ready. Yeah?
The Chairman, thank you for the very fine introduction, you know. So, can you have this? So, some technical hitches. So, salam alaikum, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much, you know, for inviting me to come down. You know. And yes, I would like to share my experience, you know, as how we developed telemedicine in Malaysia. But I will not go into details in terms of the implementation achievement and all that, you know, but I will try as I go along how we develop telemedicine, what we're trying to achieve, where are we going and leading to, and I will bring up some issues in terms of implementing issues rather than the real outcomes.
Yeah, we have telehealth, yeah.
How do we go to the next one? Okay, thank you. We started working in telemedicine way back in the early 90s. And in 1997, the government realized that, you know, we are manufacturing countries, and therefore our second engine of growth and income, you know, will be a knowledge economy. And as such, you know, we developed under what we call the our multimedia initiative to create a corridor in Malaysia, so-called multimedia super corridor. By one of the things is for us to ensure that the engine of growth is one of those is in relation to health. And as such, we created a telehealth as part of the other project for for the smart schools, electronic governments, and a few others. Yeah.
How do I go next one?
Yeah. The background information about Malaysia is located in Southeast Asia. Its neighbors are quite many big countries around us. We are small in Malaysia, China, Japan, India. We have Brunei, Philippines, and Thailand, you know, which are quite familiar countries, you know, in this part of the world. We are make out of two land masses, combined size as big as Japan. Population is only 23 million. It's a developing country, but has problems of a developed world, you know, medically, in terms of heart diseases and air accidents. And is a visionary country, you know, aimed to be fully developed nation by the year 2020, and as such, all our programmings and, you know, whatever activity we do, we hope to achieve this, you know, not economically, but also the other aspects, you know, so that, you know, things will go in tandem. Economically, we are basically manufacturing countries, you know, we are the biggest microchip producers in the world. We are moving towards, and as I told you earlier, to be complemented by knowledge economy as an additional engine for economic growth, and that's why telehealth has come to be in, yeah? In terms of population ratio, ratio population to telephone usage, because we're making use of the internet, is 1 in 15. The public health facilities, we have 200 community nurse clinics, which have no doctors there. We have 770 health clinics. Some of those have got doctors. And, oh, the symbol's wrong there, no? So we have approximately 120 public hospitals, and we are connected by a health virtual private networks, which only runs in public clinic, public facilities, not yet by the private sectors. We have private practitioners back home, 2,700 of them, you know, basically handling primary care, and we have 197 private hospitals. There are more private hospitals than public hospital in Malaysia, but they are very small, you know. But, you know, they only provide 18% of the total hospital beds. In terms of internet users, we have about 1 million, but, you know, one internet users normally have five people sharing that. You know, we have approximately about 4 to 5 million of internet users. This is a vision for the health vision, you know. It's been vision, been shown yesterday, to create a nation of healthy individuals, families and communities through a healthcare system. Through a healthcare system. It's equitable, affordable, efficient, technologically appropriate, environmentally appropriate and consumer friendly. Yeah? This, I saw some of this being quoted somewhere else, you know, in our book. Yeah? So we had this about 20 years back. Yeah? It's emphasis on quality, innovation, health promotion, respect for human dignity, individual responsibility, community participation, in order to create enhanced quality of life. So this is our vision, and this has to be translated into services. And this is the mission. But most important is the health goal or the healthcare objectives. Many years back, you know, we wanted to move from the illness to wellness focus. You know, so we wanted our services to be wellness focused. Instead of service focused, it's person focused. Instead of creating a patient who doesn't know anything about health, you know, it has to be created in an informed, you know, it has to be informed person. Promotion of self-health, care provided home to close to home. At the moment, our healthcare services, you know, people basically they are, have nothing more than 15 kilometers from the home to the nearest healthcare providers. Yeah? The seamless continuous care in terms of geography and time, it's either from womb to tomb. So care has to be continuous. Services tailored to your needs, to your individuals or group needs or community needs. Yeah? And it has to be efficient and most importantly, affordable. We cannot we achieve our goals, but the services are very expensive. The other aspect, as we develop the telemedicine, we will also recognize there are future challenges, and that future challenges must be incorporated as you develop telehealth, because otherwise telehealth, you know, will be a will be a system, you know, catching its own tail. So we have to recognize that, and it has to be looked, you know, it's very dynamic and difficult part of it, because as we develop telehealth, the future challenges come in, and the system has to change. In other words, the future, the health goals are talking about the principles of the health system in the future. You have about 8 goals there, and the national vision, health vision, the mission, the goals and the challenges, you know, with that we have to move ourselves across to the healthcare system in the future. To do that, Malaysia believe that we should not have so many bridges for us to go there, because if you're going to work under IT network environment, the integration will be very, very difficult. Therefore, that single bridge will be telehealth. In order to do that, we have to create guiding policies. These are the guiding policies. We created we have to establish a telehealth blueprint way back in 1997, and to operationalize that, you know, we have to create also the telehealth policy. We would like to share you with this, you know. So this document plus this vision and the translation of the vision is a component that will push us to the healthcare system in the future. And we have to create a telehealth services that goes across one end to the other end. So telehealth, as been indicated earlier, cannot be piecemeal, but must be a structured, concerted effort to move from one point to another. And this is what about telehealth in Malaysia all about. So what are the healthcare system's future if we translate the vision, the mission, the goals, and the challenges? Focus on health promotion in healthy settings, proactive management of wellness throughout life. We do. So it's a proactive management and early detection and proactive management of disease. And telehealth must interpret this. Services close to person. Immediate person-specific information has to be delivered. Consumer is at the center, not the service at the center. And you have to redesign the services from the customer perspective. And telehealth must do this. Care provided at home or close to home. Extend more than primary and include secondary and tertiary care. Specialists must be bring down to the doorsteps of the primary care healthcare providers, you know, and there might be a seamless integration between the primary, secondary, and tertiary care. And we must find what is that linking factor, and telehealth must provide that linking factor. It links and empowers individuals and families and communities to doctors and other healthcare providers. In relation to empowerment, healthcare providers are patient-centered, high accountability, quality of human interaction, high patient relationship, and high quality of human interaction. Sorry, that repeated. So these are the service, you know,
must not be have that telehealth must not be a service that have a low touch but high technology. It must be a system that creates high touch and high technology, and it's a big challenge for us for this to be translated into telehealth. The health system of the future, management of wellness and illness throughout life, which is very difficult because things have been episodic, you know, no matter how. Remember, but no matter, you know, 23 million to us is still a big population, and it's very difficult, you know, this to be done. So proactive risk intervention and early detection and management of diseases and proactive management of diseases. So we're talking about preventive and promotion, more wellness concept. The other component is the promotion of self-service, self-care, self-help. So patients should not flood the health system just because the system are there. So another activities related to telehealth might be created to support self-help, self-care. A risk assessment has to make if you were to have early intervention. So you have to prioritize strategy and intervention to risk group must be done at a very early stage, and telehealth must be able to assist this. The system will be very busy if you don't provide health call centers, you know. But the health call centers are not for illness interaction, but more for wellness interaction, so that patient can have a good continuity of health care. So interactive centers to ensure continuity and accessibility to care, and care are given irrespective of place and time. So health call centers, this has not been discussed in this meeting today. Yeah. So, in other words, telehealth will set the foundation of the health system in the future. We are going to bridge, hopefully, the health services and the creation of new services that's not possible to practice by existing methodology, because we're making use of information and communication technology, and allow also healthcare providers, which are they are longing for, to adopt new roles and in order for them to have expanded and extended roles in healthcare delivery. So, how did we do it some time back? What was done was that goals and vision and health goals, national goals, health vision and goals have to be translated into what will be the health service master plan. And these are reviewed 5 yearly, and we have this for the next 20 years. The health ICT strategic planning was developed and has been going on for the last 20 years, that developed. And these are translated into what telehealth can do. And we developed the telehealth concept proposal documents. And this will be one that we tender out to the private sectors. And that system should be part of the telehealth services that support the existing system in back home. So this is how it was done. We call the international expert panel to assist us to develop this. We have a nationwide strategic planning so that this ICT planning is ongoing with the other ICT strategic planning in the other government sectors. And we call international panel to develop the concept of proposal. These are basically tender certification that will translate this into health services, and we award the tenders and they implement that. So telehealth is an enabler that where it's just a component of the existing health services achieving the healthcare system of the future. In other words, when we think about, you know, when we decided that if telehealth is the only bridge that will link us from the existing to the future healthcare system, telehealth must adopt a bigger role, you know. It cannot be just teleconsultation. It has to be more than that, you know. As such, you know, we define telehealth, you know, in much more broader aspect in terms of clinical information and other information and combined together with communication, human-machine interface technology, with all the rest of the health technologies available. These are integrated not only to deliver health, promote as well as to create health. So our understanding of telehealth are very wide. You know, probably some of us will not agree, but this is what we meant by telehealth back home. So if you were to argue on that, you know, this is our scope. So this is the telehealth definition that we have, you know, that been used locally back home. Yeah, if you look at this closely, it's very close to what been defined by NASA, you know, NASA in the United States. The other component as we develop telehealth is to ensure that other people buy into our system. It cannot be too customer focused, but the other stakeholders too have to be addressed, you know. So the personal center, but the universities, the health industries, the facilities, hospitals, and the clinics, the healthcare givers, the healthcare providers, and the funders and the payers have to address, you know. And how did we do that? We discussed with them what will be their benefits if telehealth were to be developed. And this is some of the conclusion that we have, you know. These are individuals, and we talk to them, they prefer continued care close to the home, equity access, exercise health right choice, able to exercise the right health choices, and to create affordable services. Discussion with the healthcare facilities, basically they want to improve efficiency and productivity so that they can increase costs, continue care so that, you know, the patient come back to them all the time and they want to prefer better health outcomes. The benefit of healthcare givers, you know, if telehealth were to be implemented, is continuous upgrading of knowledge and professional competence through distance learning, delivery of personalized information and advice to patients. To the payers, you know, these are the advantages, and therefore that the telehealth must incorporate in all these benefits. These are the healthcare industries. One of the things that you found from them is that healthcare industries, the creation of health portals, they have the ability to attract and retain customers. You know? This is what they wanted. The best media to promote their products via e-commerce. Customer guaranteed of quality and reliable information advice. Access to health information education can become a powerful health portal. You know, this is what the industry thought. Promotion of health-related products to targeted customers. So this has to be incorporated into the system. So when we start looking at the whole thing, you know, so individuals and healthcare providers need a few things, you know, if telehealth were to be successful, besides all the benefit that we talked earlier. It's consultation, either face-to-face or teleconsultation, the maintenance of medical records, health planning for the patient, to indicate the patient what he has to do in terms of time and facility settings, and health information education for the healthcare providers. And also to assist healthcare providers with medical education at point of care, in other words, continuing medical education. These are translated into the four components of telehealth that we developed in Malaysia. The lifetime health plan have got the health record and the healthcare plan, health information and education are given for the public. Of course, the MACPIE is a misnomer. You know, if you take MCP, that stands for MACPIE, yeah? And the continuous medical education, the CME, and teleconsultation for both face-to-face and also distant teleconsultation, or the so-called teleconsultation. So what's a PLHP, a personalized lifetime health plan? It's a proactive and prospective healthcare plan that have got wellness. It's a generic plan given to everybody as long as he's well. Once he's ill, you know, he'll be provided with a care plan, a so-called illness plan, to maintain you in the highest possible state of health. But the PLHP, the Personalized Lifetime Health Plan, you know, must not be a standalone piece of electronic information. It must be able to link health information education for the individuals. It must be able to support either face-to-face or teleconsultation as when required. In the PLHP, the Personalized Lifetime Health Plan, besides the Personalized Lifetime Health Record being kept, it will have two components, the health plan and the care plan. This is a generic one that will push us from womb to tomb, and as you become ill, the appropriate illness or the care plan are given to you. Once you recover, you continue back with your wellness plan. So the wellness plan will basically tell you when is vaccination, screening, and the other aspect, you know, in terms of wellness care. So this is how we work about, you know. So I just want to point out a very busy diagram is the personalized lifetime health record, clinical record that you keep to yourself. This is just a subset of the multiple EMR as you collect them during your different encounters with the healthcare providers. A very small percentage of that is called a lifetime health record, and because it's personalized to you, we call it personalized health record, and that is incorporated into the personalized lifetime health plan. Because we know you electronically, the right appropriate healthcare plan can be given to you, and so the right health information education can be delivered to you from time to time. PLHR or the Personalized Lifetime Health Plan are selected on the basis that it ensures continuity of care and nothing else. So in other words, the detailed component of electronic medical record will not be kept in the LHR. And this data set I made public, and both the public and the private sectors, you need to share this data set so that we're going to make it mandatory for them to pump the information into these databases. So the mass customized health information education basically should have a personalized information and education. We know that general information for patients are not very useful, and therefore that has to be personalized. How do we personalize? Because we knew you electronically in terms of what's your age, what's your clinical problem, where do you stay, and so forth. and that personalization can take place. But additional to personalized information, other information too must be provided, you know, otherwise our system will not be complete. Number two is a continuing medical education. Our objective is to create, to deliver just-in-time continuing medical education that is a relevant package of medical information at the point of care to assist in clinical decision and patient care. So to do that, the whole gamut of medical knowledge have to package in the right package and deliver at point of care. And there's a big application, you know, that you need to support that. So evidence-based medicine, CPGs, you know, medical textbooks, on the government reports, you know, proceedings of meeting, these have all to be coded, you know, and that will be linked from the electronic identity of the healthcare providers or doctors, you know, and as they view patient, the patient's information are linked together with that healthcare provider's electronic information, and that right knowledge will push over to deliver just in time, same. So this is to ensure that, you know, our healthcare providers are not drowned with medical knowledge. Yeah? So, but to complete it, you know, the distant learning, you know, we need to support distant learning, whereby the non-hands-on skills are delivered through our system, but the hands-on skills go back to the training colleges and they provide all the certification. Yeah? And also, we also provide the health professional committee online, where professional people, chat group, you know, can take place. This is just a... These are all free, you know, to the system. So teleconsultation is just a small bit in what we are doing. It's a utilization of standardized, but what we emphasize in teleconsultation is the utilization of standardized protocols and procedures, which are very proactive, you know, in to ensure health record sharing. You know. But it does not, it covers not only for in terms of competency and second opinion, but it covers from the whole spectrums of clinical care up to rehabilitation and palliative care. And it's very difficult to develop this, yeah? Because the protocols, you know, varies. So this is a component where each of those are linked together. Consultation, the LHP, the SME, and the MACPIE, all those are linked together. But a more complex view is how we look like. The main objective from perspective of the individuals is to create the personalized lifetime health plan. And these are done through multiple applications were developed through a system. And additional to that, there are numerous rules and logics have to be agreed, you know, by both the public and the private sector healthcare providers. See? To support all this application, very critical are to create the contents, because continuing medical education, MACPIE, and even the care plan, these are very content-rich type of activities, and they have to develop. Yeah? Of course, the spillover of the system is a group data services where data mining, marketing, trend analysis, epidemiology can take place. Yeah? So numerous applications reside behind this diagram. So what is the bridge that links the whole of the telehealth system in Malaysia? There must be a bridge, otherwise, you know, why must people come to our system, you know? So is that bridge just lifetime health record has been proposed, you know, have been discussed for the last 2 days, you know? But we thought it's more than that, you know. Personalized lifetime health record will not be a good integrating factor to the whole system. What we thought would be the care plan, the personalized lifetime health plan, where a component of it is the lifetime health record, yeah? And if you were to have personalized lifetime record as the major integrating factor, we are able to deliver care from home, primary care, secondary, tertiary care, and that cover from private down to the public health facilities. You know, probably you might not agree with me, you know, but this would be the main integrating factor, the PLHP. Because here I know what a patient will do, and that activity must be shared by both the public, private, and the public health facilities. Even if you just focus on health records, it doesn't mean much to the private sector, because he can create his own care plan, and that differs completely different from the public health sectors. So we're making use of web technology wherever possible, you know, and it's accessible from home, from kiosks, from hospitals, away from home. Yeah. I'll talk a bit on the business models, because this, what we propose, is not only meant for public sectors, but also to be shared by the private sectors, you know. So the business models are very critical, otherwise in Malaysia, half of the health sectors are health services undertaken by the private sectors, and we must make them comfortable, you know. So what we did was that we must ensure that, you know, as you develop telehealth, which, you know, some of those require very high funding, you know, upfront cost to create content, application developments, yeah, like for instance, like PLHP and health information education for the public and the continuing medical education because doctors are rare species. Yeah. So those are to be developed based on a business model called build, own and operate, whereby the private sectors come in, pump their money in, invest, create the services for the next 5-10 years, create a good revenue model in terms of advertisement and so forth, and then the system is sustainable. On the other hand, if it's just simple teleconsultation, which I know established health services and all that, we know what to buy, you know, when to buy, you know, we propose a build, own and operate and transfer, whereby they build up the system, make it run, and we're happy, we pay the money, and, you know, it comes back, and the system goes to us. Yeah? So these are the business model that we have, you know, back home. So what most important is that the system might be sustainable telehealth business to ensure that the public and the private sectors, you know, can collaborate for us, you know, for a long, long time. So this way we're going to implement the system have been planned for the last 3 years. You know, this year we start implementing the services. The teleconsultation will link 42 hospitals and health centers all over Malaysia. Health information and education for the public will be internet-based. The continuing education will be on the internet-based. And the LHP, because some of those have got some upfront infrastructures, you know, located in an area in the peninsula of Malaysia that will, you know, serve about 3.5 million out of 23 million people. But some of the services are available via the internet. Yeah? It has to be done incrementally. Yeah? So we realize that we cannot cover the whole spectrum of 27 disciplines, 28 disciplines of medical services. It was covered, you know, for the next 5 years, you know, these diseases and problems that we have in Malaysia that kill 1 in 2 of Malaysians will be covered, you know, in terms of cardiovascular health management, injury prevention and management, cancer prevention and management, antenatal and perinatal health and prevention. So that will be covered, you know, hopefully, and over the years, more and more programs will be added, you know, that cover probably the other aspect of the health discipline. So these transformations are gradual. We are not going to do overnight. As I told you earlier, these are the 4 programs about over the years. You know, we have planned for the next 20 years. You know, more programs will be added. Hopefully that at the end of the day, we will be able to achieve the health system of the future. Yeah? That transformation can take place. But critical today is you must reduce the existing healthcare system. Because if this keep on increasing, this increase at a slow rate, you will never achieve that. Yeah? So we hope to achieve this in the next 20 years. Gradually, you've got to reduce that green component, the existing health services, you know, at the end of the day, it just become a service. Yeah? So where are we? Where are we in terms of what we're going to do in terms of telehealth? You know, if this is a progress of telehealth, where at the end of the day, it just become a health system, you know, where we hope to achieve population health. Initially, many years back, we were concentrating on acute illness management, and then it came on to chronic disease management. Now we're talking about wellness management, you know. So we are somewhere there, you know, whereby we are trying to create medical records and healthcare plans. Yeah? So one day we hope that with the creation of PLHP and the using the full potential of group-related services, we're able to create custom health. You know, in other words, if you have a community, we're able to create health services that customized for the community, understanding what are the problems they have in the community. Yeah? So we have a long way to go. Yeah? So what are the things that we have to look when we implement this? Certain things we have to do back home. You know, one of them is reorganization of the healthcare services. We have to reorganize the primary, the secondary, and tertiary care where they are linked and seamlessly linked. You know, there's a lot of the resource and the data sharing, you know, that take place. Yeah? The other bit is that the most difficult bit is managing change, you know, because these are new way of doing things and people don't want to change, you know. And the change have not only from the patient from home, but also the healthcare providers in the healthcare settings, but cover both the public and the private sectors, and looking at very different way of looking at healthcare, where now doctors are more, they are accountable to the system. You have to create a high trust with the high doctor relationship, the high quality of human interaction, despite making use of IT. And so these are the issues that we have to assist, you know, as a, have to address, you know, as we develop the system and has to be incorporated into the system. The third thing, you know, that we have to ensure that, you know, to ensure that there are public confidence, you know, the system must be secured, you know, and therefore legislation, acts and regulation has to be created, you know. So before we even implement telehealth, you know, in this year, the Telemedicine Act was bringing down to the Parliament, the Computer Crime Act, you know, Digital Signature Act was created, the Multimedia and Communication Act, and now we are preparing the Data Protection Bills, you know, which are in drafting, we hope will be read this year, you know, in the Parliament. Yeah. These are things have come into place. Yeah. Otherwise, your system will have no public confidence and people will not buy in your system because there is no rules and regulation, you know, to protect the citizens. Yeah. So at the end of the day, what does it mean? If this is a telehealth services, and these telehealth services are to support the big health services that will achieve the vision and mission, and it must work through a coordinated multimedia network, we must put our organization and people right first. We must ensure that the protocols and processes are being shared and agreed by as many parties as possible. The business model and the financing, you know, has to be addressed. The right policies, which like for instance telehealth policies and other policies, laws and regulation, and standards, which include both technical and clinical performance standards, you know, has to be established, you know, before I can offer telehealth services. Yeah. And of course, illness is something of second nature to our core activity in healthcare. But now we are looking at wellness. You know, there are, you know, different ways of doing things, you know, in these health services. Yeah. So these are the health systems of the future. If this is the bridge, you know, the continuing education, LHP, teleconsultation, the MAGPIE is the bridge that will push us to the future healthcare system. We must bear in mind that these services must be increased in terms of width and breadth over the years. Because if it remains status quo, you will never achieve this. Because the expectation of the population, and probably this will change too with time. Yeah? So that second one. The component that now we have four components, what will be the fifth, sixth, and seventh component that to be added in order for us to achieve, you know, our expectation in the next 20 years. Yeah? So the bridge get bigger, you must shrink the existing health system, increase this component to accommodate, you know, the future health characteristics. Yeah? So the concrete remark will be telehealth is a technology enabler to realize the vision of health. The reorganization of health system must take place, you know, and we have major emphasis on wellness, self-help and sub-services, and we have to work in a more virtual, more integrated and more distributed approach to the delivery of care services, and therefore we have to change ourselves, you know. So in conclusion, these are the forces of change and we have to change. Globalization, internet and knowledge based economy, deregulation and cross-border commerce. This will happen whether we like it or don't like it. And we must adapt this, you know, while things are very young, during the very early stage at infancy. If you were to come a bit late, you know, we will never catch up. Yeah? So we must adapt to changes while changes are still in infancy. And the telehealth project must gear to this so that we are able to take up that challenge. So thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Yeah? Yeah? Thank you very much. Yeah?
Thank you very much, Dr. Arif, for a very interesting presentation. You know, I really believe that you can't hear enough about Malaysia. I mean, it's a unique experiment in the world in terms of a country kind of doing it by the textbook. Everything you see in their plan, by the way, is really kind of textbook style, and I often wonder just how much one can really take the theory and apply it in real life and what would come out at the end. And it's always exciting then, therefore, to kind of watch and follow up on the...